Welcome back to the Florida Parish Sportsman, Wayne Glascock, on loop number six. How about that? Six shows already, or fixing to be six shows on the Great American Loop, a trip that my wife and I made, and I guess transversed the eastern coast of Louisiana back down the river system. If you've watched the first five shows, you know what it is, and I won't bore you with all those details again. But it is an adventurous trip, and many of those people, myself included, would say that maybe the highlights of the trip, or at least some of the top two or three highlights of the trip, took place for us while we were in Canada. Now, our last show was pretty much in the country of Canada. We started the Trent Severn, and we ended the last show with going through the highest lock, the highest hydraulic lock in North America. There's one in Europe, in Scotland, as the gentleman explained to us, the lock master at the lock in Peterborough, that there's one higher, but this one is the oldest and the largest. It's 75 feet, if I remember this correctly. But if you watch segment number five, you'll see right at the end, he's got the full description. But it's a heck of a process in which you take the boat into a channel, a canal, and there's two locks, one of which, you know, is at the bottom, the other at the top. And as old Archimedes would say, you put a little bit more weight here and the hydraulics would lift. And that's basically what you do. You put a foot more water in the bottom lock and in the top lock, and it forces, or actually what you do is put 1 foot less in the bottom lock. We found that out in the next lock. You'll see that on this segment. But they put 1 foot less, and then it rises the boat. And it's like being in the bathtub, you know, in a 45-foot boat. You're sitting there, and it lifts. And this thing lifts 75 feet, almost eight stories in the air. You lift it just like being in a bathtub, basically. It's got a steel chamber that closes on both ends. But anyhow, that was last segment. We're going to take back up now where Trent Severn actually narrows it, and as any waterway, the intercoastal waterway, the Atlantic coastal waterway, wherever, the Gulf coastal waterway, you have narrowed man-dredged parts, and then you have natural parts, which are bays or lakes or estuaries that you go through, and then these man-made channels, canals, link those together. Well, it's the same in the Trent Severn. I think the Trent Severn's 250 miles or so. Don't hold me to none of these numbers, but it's 45 locks and I think 250 miles. But you got a good distance to travel to get to Trenton on the eastern end of the canal, and Severn on the western end of the canal. After you leave there, you go through the Georgian Bay and then North Channel, and then you got to cross one of the lakes. You can go into Lake Superior, come back, or cross Lake Huron. But anyhow, we started this trip in, again, the narrow part of these channels where literally they're houses on either side, and they're not, it's a very narrow channel. So you think of here in Louisiana where you have a river, the Amite River or the Tickfall River or Blind River or wherever that is, it's wide. Just imagine about a third that size, maybe even less than that, the size of a good canal. And with houses right up to the edge on both sides. So that's what we started off when we left the hydraulic lock, headed to the second highest hydraulic lock in North America. There's two on the Trent Severn out of the 45 locks. And we'll do the big chute later. I'm going to save that for last. But the second hydraulic lock between the first hydraulic lock, which is lock 42 maybe in Peterborough, Canada, and the next hydraulic lock is six or seven locks down. But anyhow, the distance in between there is very narrow, and it is the highest, it's not the furthest north point. We're almost there. It's just a few miles from where we're going. But it's the part of the Trent Severn that was dredged in pure rock back in the 1800s, early 1900s, whenever it was dredged. And the Parks Canada, who operates the canal and all of the parks in Canada, well, great people, by the way. They only guarantee 4 foot of depth. And you have to sign a waiver when you get there that you understand they're only guaranteed 4 foot of depth. And in most places, it's a lot more than that. But I think what they was talking about when they asked that was this particular canal, which was dredged, is very narrow, straight as an arrow. But at some point, you were literally 30, 40 feet from either side with trees hanging over and sheer rocks here. And when you look out the bow of the boat, you can see the rocks. It's almost like being in the Caribbean where you see these rocks and you're worried about it. And in their case, it's in the Caribbean, sometimes it's 20 foot deep. But here, they only guaranteed 4 feet, so we were wondering, because top secret draws 3.5 feet. So really, we only had 6 inches of clearance between our props. We have free props, too. We don't have a keel that would protect us, the props. We have props exposed. So if we hit pure rocks there, both the props, both the shafts were probably gone. We'd have been towed in major, major. But I trusted the instruments on this thing. I trusted Parks Canada that it was at least 4 foot. And we took off and went. So we went through this narrow part and through the homes and stuff, and then made our way up to the next hydraulic lock. Okay, hydraulic lock number 2 on the Trent Severick. Again, you saw where we went through lock number 1, and the lock number 2 is 6 or 7 locks down, I don't remember exactly, but and a little bit less high, not as high as the lock in Peterborough, which I think was 75 or 80 feet, whatever. This one was a little bit shorter, but not by much, 65 maybe. But it was more exposed. It was out in the open. It wasn't nearly as big a locking apparatus as they had at Peterborough, and the wind was whistling that day. But anyhow, the channel came up and dead end, where when you're going, you know, from east to west as we were, you come in at the bottom lock. You really don't recognize how far it is down. But when you come in to this next lock, the lock was up, then they're locking you down. So when you come in, you actually look up to the edge. And then you can see down, and you'll see in some of these shots, it's, you know, 70, 75 feet down to the water basin again. And again, you got rocks and trees on the side, we're all higher than the trees. But anyhow, we went into this last hydraulic lock on Trent Severn. And we had our friends behind us. We hooked up with them. We actually met them in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, Myrtle Beach Yacht Club, and became friends and kind of moved back and forth. We saw him again out of, we met him again in Norfolk, Virginia, and saw him there. I think they left before us and went on ahead to maybe wherever the next place was, Northern Virginia. And we caught up with them. It might have been Delaware, wherever it was. We caught up with them and kind of hooked up there and traveled together. From there, all across Canada, back into Lake Michigan, where Sue Hammond, Tom and Sue Hammond, our friends on the boat that travel with us, is from Michigan, the state of Michigan. So she was going back to her home waters, and luck we did. We're going to do a full show on that as well. But the going through this lock, and as you can see in the shots here, that we pull into the lock, you can see the depth down. Now we could see that before because we. In the other lock, because we lifted up, the lockmaster allowed us to turn around and come back into the lock, spend the night. So you could see it down. But here, you're actually pulling the boat in, and you're able to look over. So they're telling you, you know, stop. You got people on either side telling you, you know, giving you instructions on what to do. But, you know, we're old hands at this. By then, we've probably done 60, 70 locks. So we come back to the boat. We lock through this hydraulic lock. And when we get back down, the water becomes, as I tell you, the wind was blowing pretty hard that day. And it's hard enough. But once we came down out of that lock, we started facing a big current, something that we really hadn't faced before. Again, locking down, so the current going with us, and in some places coming back toward us. But we started facing the current. But the topography kind of changed, where you're more rural. Prior to that, you could see that this was more settled, nicer homes, deeper water, lots of rock outcrops, and islands, and nice either full-time homes. I would imagine these are summer homes or lake houses, whatever those people call them there, whatever the Canadians call them, probably lake houses. But some really nice homes. It reminds me of maybe Hot Springs with all these gorgeous homes on these outcrops of islands and stuff around. But through there to the last lock at Severn. We stayed at a marina just prior to the lock, the last maybe the marina in Canada before Severn. And that lock, which was only 8 or 9 feet, is the last lock. And then you enter the Georgian Bay. Southport, really nice place. It was a new marina, had really nice clubhouse, had cooking facilities, had extremely nice people, very well attended staff, as well as the residents there. Invited us to come eat and hang out with them a while, and it was really a very nice place to stay. And we stayed there a couple, 3 days, kind of reprovisioned and rested up, because we'd been going through these locks, and we were getting ready for the next part of this adventure, which was pretty much open water, or no more locks until we got all the way to Michigan, I guess. But anyhow, you go through the Georgian Bay, and here again, these great rock outcrops, almost like the Thousand Islands that we had seen earlier in the trip. With these great rock outcrops, with a few trees and some dirt, and these nice homes on them. Most one per outcrop or per island, and some had two or three. I would assume they belonged to families, or maybe not, maybe friends, or maybe just different residents building on the same island, partitioning the property up. But here are some really nice homes. Again, we started having this current, which was okay. And then we started getting open water. We, instead of the channel that we'd been going through the Trent Severn and these small locking process, which is probably 25 or 30 feet wide, we went to pretty much open water. And clearer water, or maybe my imagination clearer water, but you'll see too in the last of these locks, the middle of these locks, I'm a skip and go back. And the reason I'm not doing it, because we actually had a narrative in the show that I actually spoke going through the big chute, which was really kind of the high point of our trip. Then the hydraulic locks were great, but this big chute is something that struck my imagination when I looked at this way back early when I started thinking about going on this trip. This is a place where you take the boat, take your boat, and according to the size of your boat, in our case, they could only take one at a time. But in other cases, they'll put 6 or 8, 10 boats on this rail system. Welcome back to the Florida Parish Sports. The Big Chute, that's where we are in Canada. One of a kind. You see this rail lift lifting this over this ridge here, almost a mountain. A little rough going too. Allow you to stay on the boat. Bring the boat in, lift it up on straps, and take us over the chute. If you pan that way and see, it's a pretty good drop. It's about 80 feet down and about a 4.5 minute run. Top secret, first time. Well, actually, we've taken her out of the water a couple of times to get it operated on. And bottom pain and stuff. But this is the first time she's ever done anything like this. And this is one of the reasons that I did this trip, or came this route. We had a choice of either going through the Erie Canal, which we did for like 160 miles, and then we turned north and came into Canada. But this is the highlight of most everybody's trip to Canada. If you'll notice, we can go down almost a 45 degree angle, and while they're going at an angle, the boat is actually swinging forward. So quite an experience, quite a trip. We've done so far about 3,500 miles. We've done about the same thing with side trips. We're headed from here into Georgian Bay. It's not far. We've got a new marina right around the corner here for a couple of nights. Get the top secret all polished up and ready to go. And when we leave here, either tomorrow or day after tomorrow, we head to Georgia Bay. The furthest north that we will travel in Canada will be coming up shortly. But look over the shoulder right here. Isn't this amazing? This is an amazing piece of equipment. And this is an amazing country, guys. And this is an amazing group of people here. Could not have been any nicer. Everyone on this trip has been absolutely terrific. But maybe the highlight of the trip. For some, it is the highlight of the trip. For me, it's the all of it together. The scenery, the incredible sports life up here is just unbelievable. I don't think that there is a time since we've been in Canada, which has been about 2 weeks, that I haven't heard geese honking or I haven't heard mallards quacking. And fish jumping, it's a terrific area. All right, we started the 45 degree downslide here. And as you can see, she goes down. And if you see there, it is actually a rail system that takes you from one side to the other. Do you think they'd do this, or the question would be, why would they have such a lift? And the answer is to stop invasive species. There's an eel, a lamprey eel, that is found in these waters over here that are not over here. And all of the beautiful things you've seen us do for the last few days, last few weeks actually, the Canadian authorities think that fishery would have been harmed greatly or maybe decimated if the eel was able to come from this body of water to this. So the only way that you can get a boat from here over to there is to do it. And you have people, as you saw when they picked the boat up, check to make sure that there's nothing invasive that we're taking from one side to the other. Getting to the end of the journey, I'm fixing to have to crank this boat up, get on up to our marina for just another sporting adventure on the Florida Panhandle. Stay with us. Bill and Bob are in Europe right now. We've been trying to get them to come hook up with us and take at least part of this trip. Haven't happened, but I got my baby girl, Carly, and my grandson, Tanner, and Andrew. All three of them have been on three or four different trips, and we're gonna all kind of meet up in Chicago and do some of the Lake Michigan and Great Lakes here. But almost to the end of our trip. Stay with us on the Florida Parish Report. We'll film all of this and see as it goes, but I gotta crank this boat and get us out of here. Once in the Georgian Bay, and then later the North Channel, again, pretty much open water. There's some great scenery there. This is one of the few times on this trip that we anchored. Now, the anchoring is fun, and I enjoyed doing it, but we just didn't do it that much. We normally did it when there was no other option. And I enjoyed it, honestly. But where there's a nice marina that you can pull up to, get out, take a shower. Of course, we got two showers on the boat, but, you know, get out, stretch your legs and go get a nice dinner at a nice restaurant and kind of visit. When that opportunity is available, we usually took it. But when going from Severn, the last port on the Trent Severn, through the Georgian Bay, now there's some nice towns and great anchorages there as well, and nice marinas too. But we decided to anchor. We anchored one time in front of this little restaurant, real famous restaurant there, and kind of dinghied in and ate, and the food was excellent. The entire country, the people in Canada were just, could not have been any greater. The scenery was absolutely fantastic. The accommodations, I mean, all very nicely kept and, you know, a little different than our style down here, but intrinsic to that area. Very nice structures, and you could just tell it was very nice, but people take a lot of pride in their places. So when we left there, the anchorage, again, we crossed a big bay, and I don't remember the name of it, but we got a little sporty for us. And anytime, my wife's actually pretty good with the sport stuff. She just sleeps when it gets like this, she takes her a couple of pills. And it got pretty sporty on us for a full day. I'd say from 9 o'clock it started rolling on. So almost turned around, went back to the anchorage and waited another day. And I said, heck, it was to our stern, which we, the top secret takes the boat pretty well, that takes a sea pretty well that way. And our friends didn't complain. I asked them and they said, no, they were good. So we went ahead and went to this anchorage called the Bustard Islands. Again, if I'm wrong, I think it's the Bustard Isle. It's an anchorage inside these islands, an outcrop, with a little cove in the middle, narrow entrance into it, a protected cove, and then little chenas, as we call them, little cuts through there that would go into other coves, and they had two or three summer homes, maybe four or five summer homes on this one place that we stayed, but a real famous anchorage on this place, and it was absolutely gorgeous. I mean, literally gorgeous. We get in the dinghy and take a ride and go around seeing, you'll see that. And as a matter of fact, we're going to try to probably stop it here. I never know what our time's going to do, but Paul's sitting there giving me, you know, been giving me this for a while. So anyhow, we're going to try to end it here. And then we'll pick back up right here. I'm not going to leave any parts of the trip. And there's some real fun stuff coming. Maybe my number one thing, it will be in probably in the next show or maybe the second show of things I did on this trip. I'm gonna say that till we get there. But anyhow, this was one of the very best parts of the trip. And as you'll see, we're going to leave you right here. We're anchored in the Bustard Cove. I don't know if it's named the Bustard Cove. It's the Bustard Islands, and it's an anchorage in this protected cove in the Bustard Islands, a real famous anchorage. And we spent the night there, anchored, took a little dinghy ride, did the sights, came back to Top Secret, and then watched the sunset over that little bitty narrow cut that brought us in there. It was quite a sight to see. So there's also, as I told you before, there's a lot, every town we went to, there was really something going on because the canal or the waterway is, you know, essential to the community. It's not highway, and of course they have their highways and interstates and, you know, all the same things that we have here in the States, but the town itself kind of builds itself along this route, kind of like the Erie Canal did back in when we were in New York. But anyhow, there we are on the Trent Severn anchored at this thing, and one of the stops was, actually I remember this because it was a big coin there. The person who came up with the design for the $1 coin in Canada, and I think the home of Jeopardy, whatever our Jeopardy, Alex Trebek, hometown that we anchored there. But this lady, there was a band out, and it just happened to be sitting in the boat one afternoon. I heard her sing, and she sang well. I got out and listened, and anyhow, this was her song, and this is our anchorage, and the way we're going to end this show, right here on the Florida Parish of Sportsmen, the Bill Hood Florida Parish of Sportsmen.
Thank you. Thank you.